and his pure immaculate progeny of the Ahlul Bayt, peace be upon them, especially the leader of our time, the awaited Savior, Al-Imam Al-Mahdi Ajjalallahu Ta'ala Farajah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Almighty, states in the Holy Quran, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, وَالَّذِينَ يَصِلُونَ مَا أَمَرَ اللَّهُ بِهِ أَنْ يُوصَلْ وَيَخْشَوْنَ رَبَّهُمْ وَيَخَافُونَ سُوءَ الْحِسَابِ. One of the qualities of the believers are those who establish and join the ties which God has instructed them to join and establish, and they fear their Lord, they fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they also fear the consequences of their actions in terms of being reckoned on the Day of Judgment. Sadaqallahu al-Aliyyul Azeem. A very significant aspect of our lives is our emotions. When you examine our emotions, you find that they truly drive us. They give us fuel, and they add taste to our lives. Can you picture your life without emotions? Imagine how boring and robotic we would be if it weren't for our emotions. Imagine if there was no love, no fear, no hate, no excitement, no joy, no happiness, no sorrow, no sadness. This would definitely be a very robotic, boring life. It is these emotions that truly add taste to our lives. They make our lives extremely interesting. Now, these emotions are also very difficult to control because they're so powerful. They have such a huge impact on us. Oftentimes, for the average person, it becomes difficult to control these emotions. Now, one of the most important emotions that has a huge impact on our lives is the emotion of fear. Tonight, let us examine this emotion. Let's see how we can use this emotion to achieve success in our lives. And finally, how is it that this emotion can bring us closer to our Creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we examine the emotion of fear from a scientific perspective, how is fear defined scientifically? One scientific definition of fear tells you that fear essentially is a chain reaction that occurs in the brain, and it starts with a stressful stimulus. Something triggers it, something that is stressful. And as a result, you have the release of chemicals, and what they do to your body, for example, they cause you to breathe rapidly, they cause a racing heart, and they energize your muscles. Almost every body part is affected by the emotion of fear. Even your eyes dilate so you can see better in the state of fear. Other definitions of fear tell you that the emotion of fear is a severe emotion or bodily reactions. Another definition tells you that fear is a sense of uneasiness. And what's amazing about this emotion of fear is that it generally kicks in once you perceive a threat. When you're dealing with something dangerous, something threatening, or something that you're not familiar with, something which is unknown to you, the emotion of fear tends to kick in. And that's truly amazing. When something is unpredictable, you're not anticipating something, the emotion of fear kicks in. Now, all of our instincts, our physical bodily instincts, are tied to the emotion of fear. Even, for example, when you go on the diet, right? Let's say after many years, you're gaining weight, the belly's growing, so you go on a diet. What happens is your body initially starts to store the fat. That's why some people, if they start a new diet and they don't do it the proper way, they actually gain weight, not lose weight, right? Because the body starts to store fat. Why does the body do that? Because of the emotion of fear. Your body fears what? Starvation. Because all your life you've been comfortable, you're always full, nothing's wrong. Suddenly now you're feeling hungry. So your body fears starvation, therefore it tries to compensate that by storing fat. And that actually ends up ruining your diet. This emotion of fear is truly amazing in its influence in our lives, in the influence that it has on our physical lives and on our spiritual lives. Now you may wonder, why is it that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the human being with the emotion of fear? A lot of people, when they think of this emotion, they think of it negatively. It's something that frightens you. It's something that makes you uncomfortable. It's something that scares you. Why would Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala create the emotion of fear? What's the purpose of the emotion of fear? First of all, it is this emotion that has allowed human beings and our ancestors to survive. Because it protects you from danger. When you're in a dangerous state, it is the emotion of fear that actually protects you. Without fear, believe me, millions of people, more, would have lost their lives throughout history. It is this emotion that effectively protects you. It makes you be cautious. It allows you to take precaution in everything that you do. And therefore, it is truly an amazing emotion. When the human being is presented with a dangerous situation, we have two options. We either fight the situation or flight. We fly away from the situation. It is this emotion of fear that gives you the energy to either fight something or run away from something. What gives you the energy? Let's say, for example, a thief, a robber, a murderer walks into your house, breaks into your house, and he wants to attack you. He wants to harm you, your family, steal your possessions. What is that emotion that actually gives you the courage and the energy to fight the situation? Imagine if you did not have fear, you know what you would do? You would sit there, you would smile in the face of this robber or thief, and you would tell him, come in, let me make you a nice, delicious meal. Be my guest today. Well, if you're smart and you have a plan, you could create a poisonous meal for him, you know, as in giving him a poisonous biryani. That could be another plan. But generally speaking, without the emotion of fear, you would just sit there. What is it that gives you the motivation and the energy to defend your house, to defend yourself, to defend your family? It is the emotion of fear. And that is truly amazing. But then sometimes fear causes you to run away. Let me tell you, if you're being attacked or chased by a lion, trust me, you do not want to fight the situation. Fear will energize your muscles and allow you to run away from the situation. Because it's suicide to try to fight something dangerous like that. It is the emotion of fear that actually protects you. Or sometimes, when you've done something wrong, let's say to your spouse, you've wronged them, and they're upset and they're angry, trust me, the only thing that you want to do is run away from their anger, run away from their wrath. You don't want to fight the situation. You know, as in run around the house. You know, some men run the house, others, they run around the house. When you're in such a situation, the best thing to do is to run around the house. It's okay, it's a good exception here. The emotion of fear is truly amazing in the energy that it generates. Sometimes when your land is attacked, your culture is attacked, your religion is threatened, other aspects of your life are threatened, such as your identity, it is the emotion of fear that actually gives you the energy to defend your homeland, to defend your language, your culture, your religion, your identity. It is for these reasons that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created the emotion of fear in the human being. It's a survival strategy that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us. And that's truly amazing. It's a miracle once you examine the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One interesting aspect about fear is that it also gives you the motivation to live. I remember once I was reading about this woman who was diagnosed with cancer, and she was told by the doctors that she did not have much to live. She says, subhanAllah, it is the emotion of fear that actually made me feel alive. It is the emotion of fear that gave me the motivation to fight my cancer. If it weren't for fear, I would go, hide myself in my room, suffer from depression, and die before I actually died. But it is the emotion of fear that actually made me feel alive. And subhanAllah, this is a great miracle from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a great blessing by our Creator. In fact, sometimes it is the emotion of fear that awakens us. Absolutely, fear sometimes can awaken you, because some people, I tell you, a lot of people, they're in a deep sleep in this world. Sometimes it is the emotion of fear that can actually awaken them. And hence, you know, you have this famous quote which says that a scare sometimes is worth more to a man than good advice. Some people, you advise them, they don't accept. Wise people approach them, they tell them, listen, what you're doing is wrong. You're destroying yourself, your family, you're affecting, you're impacting the community. They simply don't listen. No amount of good advice will benefit them. But sometimes a frightening situation, a good scare, actually does the job. It awakens them. You know, we see this with our children, right? You tell your two-year-old, Baba, please don't go to the fireplace. It's dangerous. It's hot. You'll hurt yourself. Don't play with this tool. It could be dangerous. They don't get it. You tell them once, twice. If you tell them 1,000 times, a child will not understand except when what? When this child actually goes to that fireplace and they actually feel the heat of the fire, they're scared, they're frightened, it does the job. It serves as a powerful lesson for them. It's the same with adults. It's the same with human beings. Sometimes it is only the emotion of fear that can actually awaken us. Now, when you examine the fears that human beings have, it is interesting to see the top fears that the average person has. When you look at the list of fears that the average person has here in the West, it's really interesting. Of course, usually number one on the list is what? Death. Most people are afraid of death. That's number one. You'd be surprised that one of the top fears that people in Western society have is what? I'm sure many of our children know. The fear of spiders. SubhanAllah. It is one amazing fear that scientists are even baffled at. You know, why is it that so many people consider spiders to be so frightening? You'd be surprised how many people are afraid of spiders more than death, more than anything else in society. I don't know, is it their, you know, dark shape, their angular legs, the way that they unpredictably move? God knows what it is. But most people, they actually fear spiders. Another fear that many people have is the fear of the future. I don't know how my future will look like. Where will I be in 10, 20 years? This is a fear many people have. Another fear that people have is the fear of failure. I don't want to fail. The fear of losing one's reputation. I don't want to lose my reputation. This is a fear that many people have. Many people are scared of heights, they're scared of being lonely, they're scared of war and violence. And by the way, a lot of people are also scared of public speaking. Do you know that 20% of the population, they're scared of public speaking, you know, publicly having to speak in front of other people more than death. 20% fear public speaking more than death. And that's truly interesting. Another fear that many people have is the fear of pain, of going through something which is painful. People who are struck with, for example, certain illnesses, the fear of pain, the thought of going through pain, is actually greater than the pain that they actually experience. And this is truly interesting to see what the common fears are. Now, when we examine the emotion of fear, because the emotion of fear is such a powerful driving force in our lives, unfortunately, you see dominant groups which have power, they will try to use the emotion of fear to achieve their own agenda, to control the masses, to shape public opinion. Every once in a while, or actually more frequently these days, we see many media outlets, they create fear amongst the population in order to shape public opinion. You know, in the last several years, one of the ways in which we see that certain media outlets have used their power to create fear is the issue of Sharia law, for example. Many of you are familiar with this. In the newspapers and the media for the last several years, certain media outlets, the way they speak about Sharia, they create this monster for you. This Sharia is this monster. It's crawling into our societies. It's dangerous. And they actually create the state of panic, the state of fear to control the masses, to shape public opinion. And interestingly, those lawmakers who try to legislate anti-Sharia laws, most of them have no clue what Sharia is. I remember several years ago in the United States, there was this Alabama state senator in the state of Alabama who was advocating for anti-Sharia. This Sharia is dangerous. We need to make legislation to ban Sharia in Alabama and in the United States. One reporter asked him, he told him, can you tell us what Sharia is? What is the Sharia that you're frightening us from? What is it? Explain it to us. You know what he said? Imagine he's got an entire campaign against Sharia. And his reply was, I don't have my file in front of me now. He did not even know what Sharia is. And I will confidently tell you that most of those lawmakers or those media outlets or these, you know, public figures who are advocating for anti-Sharia legislation, they themselves have no clue what Sharia is. You all remember Terry Jones, this man who burned the Holy Quran. He was asked, when asked, why did you burn the Holy Quran? You know what his response is? He says, because of Sharia law, that's why I burned the Holy Quran. He was asked, why? What's troubling about Sharia? He says, well, your Sharia is violent. They told him, explain to us, what is Sharia? He says, well, I'm not an expert on Sharia law, but I know that it is violent. He was asked, can you give us an example of why you burned the Quran? Where is this violence? Cite us an example. He says, well, I burned the Holy Quran. Of course, he didn't say holy. I'm using the word holy. He says, I burned the Quran because of the violence in it, because the Quran says you have to stone the one who commits adultery. Subhanallah, there's not a single verse in the Holy Quran which says that you have to stone the one who commits adultery. No verse. Bring me one verse in the Quran which says that. And yet, this is the reason why he claimed he cited that he burned the Holy Quran. Actually, when you go to the Bible, to the Old Testament, you will find that the Old Testament mandates execution, killing, to 16 or so offenses. About 16 or 17 crimes, if someone commits them, according to the Bible, then one deserves the capital punishment. For example, one of them is stoning the one who commits adultery. The Quran doesn't say that. It's actually the Bible that says the one who commits adultery, they deserve to be stoned to death. Another offense that is punishable by death, according to the Bible, is what? It's cursing your parents, being rebellious towards parents. Another one is practicing magic and sorcery. Another act that is punishable in the Bible by death, for example, is if you try to convert people to other religions, other than Christianity, for example, or Judaism, according to the Old Testament. And there are so many others. You know, if someone lies about her virginity, that's also grounds for execution. And it's amazing how ignorant these people are. They create this monster. They create this fear in the public, Sharia, Islamic law. And then they tell the people, we banned it and so we saved you. So now come vote for us. And they act as heroes in their societies. They were the ones who created the fear. Then they claim that they saved you from the fear. And in return, they want something from you, right? Come support us. Contribute to our campaign. It's a big money-making business, creating fear and having people submit to your ideas, controlling the people's minds. Even the ISIS situation that we see in the Middle East today, you know, one thing that you'll notice is ISIS has been creating havoc the last 3 years. How come the last 6 months or so we see that certain media outlets, they're focusing on the threat of ISIS? Where have you been the last 3 years? But that's another discussion. We see that these Islamophobes take advantage of these situations in order to create fear because they know very well that the emotion of fear is extremely powerful in controlling the human mind, in shaping public opinion. And they use that to achieve their own agenda. Now, as we continue to examine the emotion of fear, people may wonder, this emotion of fear that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created in us, we know that it helps us to survive throughout history. But on a daily basis, how do I treat this emotion? How do I interact with it? How can I control it? The religion of Islam, respected brothers and sisters, as we have been demonstrating the past two nights, is the path of moderation. Islam, the true religion of Islam, protects you from any type of extremism, from falling on the two sides of the extreme. The religion of Islam gives you a lifestyle that is based on true moderation. Even when it comes to emotions like fear, to achieve success, you have to find the proper balance. Because if you're the type of person who fears everything, you cannot control your fears, then you will not succeed in life. Fear will act as a huge impediment to your progress. And if you're the type of person who's completely fearless, you have no fears, no concerns at all, then you will also lead a very risky life. You will not lead a successful life. You will damage and harm yourself, harm your family, harm your society, harm your community. So we need to find that proper balance in the fear that we have and in controlling this very important emotion. So for example, when it comes to the fear that is positive, every human being should have an element of fear in him. Because there are things in life that you have to be cautious with. When it comes to the well-being of your family, when it comes to the well-being of your parents, your children, your spouse, you have to have an element of fear, right? Because if you don't have any element of fear, you will not care for them. If you don't have any trace of fear in your heart from your wife or from your husband, believe me, you will not truly respect them. You will not truly care for them. You know, they say once there was this father, he had purchased a present for his children. So he told them, listen, I will give this gift to the one of you who is most obedient. So which one of you is the most obedient? They told him, oh, father, you just caused us to lose hope. Khalas, go and give it to someone else. They said, what do you mean? I want to give it to you. They said, well, it's obviously, if the one who's the most obedient, you know, in this house is going to get this gift, then you're the one who's the most obedient to our mother. So go give it to her. None of us deserve it here. Some element of fear is good, brothers and sisters. But also, this sometimes can be too excessive. I remember in Los Angeles, we had, you know, a very dear friend. He used to memorize Dua al-Iftitah, this great dua that we recite in the holy month of Ramadan. At the end of Dua al-Iftitah, there is a short dua, you're familiar with it. Allahumma barahmatika fassalihina faadkhilna. In this dua, there is a phrase in which every believer asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give him hur al-'ain on the day of judgment. Now this respected brother, he used to memorize the entire dua. When he would come to this phrase, he would skip it. He would not, you know, narrate it. So once we asked him, why is it that when you come to this phrase, you don't say it? You know, this is a dua taught by our imams. He says, well, my wife is in the majlis, she's hearing, and I can't really mention this dua. You see, people always falling on the two sides of the extreme. But every successful human being, respected brothers and sisters, needs an element of fear. You need to fear the appropriate things in life because it is this fear that allows you to deal with these important things in a serious manner. It makes you act responsibly. But at the same time, with many people, you will find that the emotion of fear acts as a major impediment. It impedes them from achieving progress. And this is exactly what we see happening during the time of Al-Imam Abi Abdullah Al-Husayn, salawatullahi alayhi. Most people knew that the Imam alayhi salam was on the truth. They knew who he was. They knew what he stood for. The great poet Al-Farazdaq, when he was on his way back from Iraq, he met the Imam alayhi salam. The Imam was on his way to Karbala, to Kufa. The Imam alayhi salam told him, describe to me the situation in Kufa. How is it in Iraq? What did he tell him? He told him, "Oh, Hussein, I've got bad news for you. The hearts are with you, but the swords are against you." So people's hearts were with the message of the Imam alayhi salam. They knew that the Imam alayhi salam had a message of humanity. The Imam alayhi salam had a good, proper message. But the problem is that the governor of Kufa, Ibn Ziyad, this ruthless dictator, he created the state of fear. And it is this emotion of fear which stopped so many of those miserable people from joining Al-Imam Al-Hussein alayhi salam. And instead, they chose to join the wrong camp. Sometimes when we are not fearing the right things in life, brothers and sisters, this impedes us from achieving progress. You have to find that proper balance. If what you're doing is right and you know that it's your obligation to do it, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is satisfied with it, don't listen to your fears. The shaitan is using these fears to stop you. Don't we have something called tawakkul? Relying on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What does tawakkul do? وَعَلَى اللَّهِ فَلْيَتَوَكَّلِ الْمُتَوَكِّلُونَ وَعَلَى اللَّهِ فَلْيَتَوَكَّلِ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ The believers are those who have this quality. They have complete reliance on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is in this manner that they cast away their fears. When you know that you have to do something, it's your moral, religious, social obligation, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala expects it from you, cast away your fears. Don't say, "I'm afraid, I cannot do this, it's difficult for me." Never say that. Show your identity in society. Don't say, "I'm afraid to show that I'm a Muslim and I'm in love with the Ahlul Bayt." Don't say that, "I'm afraid that if I emerge with my hijab, others will look at me in a different way, how my society will view me." As long as you know that truly satisfies Allah, cast away your fears. Feel safe with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you comprehensive insurance. When you're with God, you're insured. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with you. There's nothing to fear. Look at the lives of the imams, the scholars that we have had in the past, the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So many dangers surrounded them. In this life, they led a very perilous journey. But it is the tawakkul, the reliance that they had on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that actually caused their fears to subside. They were able to control their fears. You know, having this emotion is very natural. Even Prophet Musa alayhi salam, according to the Holy Quran, when he saw that huge python, that stick turning into a snake, he also had the emotion of fear, right? Or when he killed that person and he had to run away, he also had the emotion of fear. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala trained him how to control these emotions. And this is how he achieved success. So you need to make sure that you actually fear the right things in life. Find that balance. If you find yourself that you're fearless, you have nothing to fear, realize there's a problem in your life. There are things that you have to fear. And if you realize that if you're fearing everything, then have some tawakkul. Have faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam, Allahumma salli ala. This commander of the faithful, he gives us the beautiful formula. If you fear something, what do you do? The Imam alayhi salam says, إِذَا هِبْتَ أَمْرًا. If you fear something, فَقَعْ فِيهِ. Fall in it, embrace it, go towards it. Take small steps towards it, because that will desensitize you to the fear. If you have certain fears in life, respected brothers and sisters, the best way to overcome those fears is to embrace that thing which you fear. And this is a beautiful formula that the Imam alayhi salam actually gives us. And it is extremely, extremely effective. Therefore, when we examine this emotion of fear, respected brothers and sisters, we have to realize that we need to find that proper balance. Then we will achieve success in this life. Subhanallah, when you examine the verses of the Holy Quran and the qualities of the believers, you are amazed at the power of this emotion and how it takes you to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One primary reason why many people have fears in their lives is because they are not prepared. Ask yourself, if right now you can think of a fear, ask yourself, why is it that I have this fear? Oftentimes, it is because we are not prepared. Therefore, the best way to tackle your fears and control them is to prepare yourself. Ask yourself, why do you fear death? We know God is loving, He's merciful. Why do we fear death? Because for us, death is unpredictable. We're not prepared. If you knew very well that you're prepared for death, would you have these fears? So the best way for you to control this emotion is to actually prepare yourself. That's how a believer controls his or her emotions, by making sure that he or she is prepared. If you have a job interview, right, and you're fully prepared, there's really not much to fear. Yes, there's a state of anxiety, which we'll discuss shortly, but you really don't have any fears. If you've studied well for that exam, then you don't have any major fears that will stop you from achieving progress. It's the same with death. The more familiar we become with death, the more this fear will go away, brothers and sisters. That is why the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, instructs us constantly remember death. Remind each other of death. Visit the graveyards and cemeteries. Because that will help you prepare for your final destination. Be aware of where you're going. Because when you come to embrace something which is unpredictable, something which is unknown, you don't know how it works, you don't know what to expect, this creates fears in your lives. But the believers are those who suppress their fears by effectively controlling them, and the way they do so is by preparing themselves. Now, when we examine this emotion of fear, respected brothers and sisters, we find that the Holy Quran tells us one major quality of the believers is that they have fear. For example, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَ اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءِ. The true scholars are those who fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another verse in the Holy Quran, for example, tells you the one that we recited in the beginning, وَيَخْشَوْنَ رَبَّهُمْ. One of the qualities of the believers is that they fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you examine the narrations of Ahlul Bayt, you see beautiful descriptions of believers having fear from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, fearing the Almighty God. For example, in one hadith, the first Imam of Ahlul Bayt, peace be upon him, he says, amongst the most beloved servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are those who wear the garment of fear. Allahu Akbar. What a beautiful description. Those who observe the garment of fear. Another hadith from the Imam alayhi salam. He says, the believers are those whose hearts fly with the wings of fear. Beautiful description. The Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, he says, the best moment for me is not when I'm lying on my comfortable bed watching TV, having fun. No. The Prophet says, the best moment for me is when I'm in the state of fear, when I feel afraid. This is the best moment for me. Prophet Isa alayhi salam, he says, my slogan is fear. The best moment for me is also fear. And Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam in one hadith says, he says, you cannot be a true believer unless you fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In another hadith, the Imam alayhi salam, he says, nothing can fix up a believer like fear. Fear has the ability and the power to actually fix you, to rectify you, to make you a good human being. Now the question is here, what does it mean for the believer to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Unfortunately, many of us, when we speak about the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we picture, you know, this scary figure in our minds that's chasing us throughout our lives. This is not the fear that the Holy Quran and the Ahadith are referring to. God is loving. One hadith says, God is more compassionate to you than your own parents. 70 times more than your own parents. So what is this fear that the Holy Quran is referring to? When the Imams of Ahlul Bayt, peace be upon them, used to stand in prayer, even before that, Al-Imam Al-Hasan alayhi salam, when he would perform the wudu, his face would turn yellow and his body would shake and quiver. He would be asked, Yabna Rasulullah, why do we see this emotion from you, this reaction? He says, I am standing before the King of the universe. How can I not be fearful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What does this fear mean? When we examine the fear of the believers, and this is how we use this emotion to seek closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we examine the emotion of fear in the believers, brothers and sisters, we see that love and fear are intertwined. You cannot love someone truly without fearing them. Fearing what? Fearing them hurting you? Examine your parents right now. If you truly respect your parents, and you should, when we say that you fear your parents, what does it mean that you should fear your parents? Fear losing them, right? You cannot truly love someone without fearing them. Fearing losing them. Fearing wronging them. Fearing doing an injustice to them. This is the fear that a believer should have. When we say that you fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in essence, we're saying you should love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when you truly love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you fear losing that special status with Him. This is why Imam Abi Abdullah al-Husayn alayhi salam in Dua al-Arafah, what does he say? He says, Ilahi, mada wajada man faqadak? Wa mada faqada man wajadak? God, what has he lost, the one who's gained you? If you've gained Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what has he lost? And what has he gained, the one who's lost you? A believer fears losing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the sense that you've lost that connection with your Lord. You've lost that special blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why this fear should constantly drive your heart. And this is the fear that used to run in the blood of the Imams of Ahlul Bayt, peace be upon them. The mere thought of losing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would make the Imams tremble in fear, even though they had no sins. Yes, for us, we should fear our sins. This is another reason why we should have fear, because fears protect us from our sins. You know, to give you an example, when the Quran says fear God, in essence, the Holy Quran is saying fear your own actions. Fear the consequences of your own actions. That's why one verse in the Holy Quran says, خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ, the one who fears the position of his Lord. When you think of the police, for example, or the CRA here in Canada, you know, the Canada Revenue Agency, you see, most people fear the police, right? Why do you fear the police? Have you ever asked yourself? Are the police bad, evil people? No, they're doing their job. Maybe some of them abuse their power, but most of them are doing their job. They're giving you security and safety in society, right? Why do you fear them? You actually fear your own consequences, right? When you fear a police car that you see on the freeway, you actually fear that you will speed, get in trouble, and get a ticket, right? That's the fear that you have. It's the same with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When the Quran says you should fear God, the Holy Quran is not saying you should fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or the personality of Allah. Allah is loving, Allah is merciful. The Quran is saying fear the consequences of your actions. Fear your own sins, because these sins will come to destroy you. Every sin will destroy you in this life. Unless you repent, of course, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will have mercy on you. When we examine the fear that we have, we only fear the consequences of our actions. And we fear losing that special relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You cannot truly love someone without fearing this, without fearing losing them. And this is why the Imams of Ahlul Bayt used to have that state of fear. Because this emotion of fear, brothers and sisters, demonstrates that you're serious. You know, for example, if your wedding is coming up after the month of Safar, of course. If your wedding is coming up, or you have this job interview, you're completely prepared. You've done all the arrangements. So nothing concerns you from this aspect. But you feel you have this state of anxiety, right? You're anxious. You're anxious about your wedding day. Not because you fear you've done something wrong. Not because you fear you're not prepared. No, you're completely prepared. But you still have that state of anxiety in your heart, because it demonstrates you're treating your wedding with seriousness. You're serious about it. You know, it's a major event. It's a life-changing event. When you go to that job interview, it's a decisive moment in your life. That's why you have that anxiety. Therefore, the presence of fear with respect to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala demonstrates that you respect the laws of God and that you're actually serious about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you don't find that fear in your heart, that means you're not really serious. When we examine the Imams of Ahlul Bayt, for example, the living Imam of our time, Al-Imam Al-Mahdi Ajjalallahu Ta'ala Faraja. The Imam alayhi salam is in a very interesting, paradoxical situation. On the one hand, we have a hadith from the 12th Imam, peace be upon him, in which he says, Inna Allaha ma'ana, God is with us. Wal-haqqu ma'ana, and we've got the truth. فَلَنْ يُوحِشَنَا مَنْ قَعَدَ عَنَّا. Therefore, we will not feel lonely if people abandon us. When you've got God and the truth with you, do you care if the entire world abandons you? You've got everything. You have Allah and the true path. So the Imam says, I'm not concerned. I don't have any fears as long as I have God and the truth. This is from one aspect. But then there's another side to the 12th Imam of Ahlul Bayt. In Dua al-Nudba, what do we say? أَيْنَ الْمُضْطَرُّ الَّذِي يُجَابُ إِذَا دَعَى. Where is the distressed one? The one who's in a state of distress. Even a hadith say the Imam is in a state of fear. One hadith says the Imam alayhi salam has a quality from all the prophets of God. And one quality that the Imam alayhi salam has from Prophet Musa is that he's in a constant state of fear. You would imagine, why is the Imam alayhi salam in a state of fear? When you've got Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you've got the truth, why is it that you're in the state of fear? First of all, the Imam alayhi salam is actually in a state of fear because of what goes on around the world to the oppressed and the innocent ones. I tell you, several years ago, I went to the holy city of Karbala. And one day, one of my friends over there, he took me to visit the area in which the orphans and widows used to live. Desperate situation. In the midst of the heat, we're talking about 50 degree weather there. Under the blazing sun, these orphans were sitting, having nothing. We went into their homes, and you really can't call it a home. It was, you know, a hut. A small little hut. You would see a widow with 6 or 7 orphans. Their father had been killed. And no one really cares about them. No one even supports them except something meager that they get. I tell you, after visiting those orphans on that day, for several weeks I could not eat properly. Because those striking images would not allow me to enjoy myself, enjoy my life, enjoy the food that you eat, enjoy the comfortable house that you have. Now I saw a glimpse, a fraction of what goes on in a city in this world. Imagine the Imam alayhi salam, who witnesses every act of oppression and injustice that occurs around the world. You don't think the Imam is in a state of distress? In fact, it is this state of fear that keeps the Imam alayhi salam close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because it keeps him concerned about his people. It keeps him concerned about this, about humanity. When the Imam alayhi salam is in a state of fear, when the Holy Prophet says, the best moment for me is the state of fear, is because in such moments I feel attached to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I feel as if I truly need my Creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The minute that you feel invincible, you don't need God, I'm powerful, then you've lost Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet says, the best moment for me is when I feel that I'm attached to God and I'm afraid, just like a child who is afraid who holds on to his mother. The Imams, peace be upon them, throughout their entire lives, they hold on to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this shows their level of respect for God. This shows their sincerity to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this shows that they're serious with their Creator. Unfortunately, in our lives, brothers and sisters, we're serious about many things except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When it comes to God, my relationship with God, I'm no longer serious. To give you an example of how the fear of the Imams, peace be upon them, really reflects their seriousness with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Take this example. Imagine a mother is waiting at home for her son to come back. He walks in, she looks at him. He is perfectly healthy. He is perfectly wrong. There's nothing wrong with him. He tells her, mother, I have some bad news to tell you. But alhamdulillah, it ended well. On my way today from school, from work, coming back home, I ran into this severe accident. And my car was totaled. Here, let me show you my car. He takes her to the garage and she sees his car just being towed and it's completely totaled. But she sees that he's perfectly fine. He's healthy, he's not injured. She's certain 100% that he's fine. So she has no doubts that he was impacted by this accident. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved him from this accident. But I tell you, what is the natural reaction of a mother when she sees that car totaled and she thinks about this accident? Immediately she starts to panic. Why does she panic? She knows he's perfectly fine. She sees him, he's in front of her. He's breathing, he's speaking, he's smiling, he's laughing, he's thanking God for being saved from this accident. But the thought of her son running into that accident actually causes major panic in her heart. And this demonstrates that she loves her son, that she's serious about him. Imagine a mother who comes out from the house and she sees the car and she says, okay, yalla, let's go and party right now. And she does not, you know, show any sign of, you know, cautiousness about this event, any sign of fear, any sign of panic. You know, the son will tell his mother, mother, do you really love me? Do you imagine what could have happened to me? You didn't show any fear, any panic. It is this emotion of fear which was existent in the hearts of the Imams of Ahlul Bayt, which demonstrated how much they loved Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They did not fear the personality of God. They did not fear their sins. They did not fear the consequences of their actions because they were infallible. But this fear caused them to truly love and respect Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to work day and night to serve Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The thought of dissatisfying Allah, displeasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would create this major fear in the hearts of the Imams, and that's how they achieved the peak of humanity. It is through this emotion of fear. Therefore, when you think of this emotion, brothers and sisters, don't think of it negatively. Think of it as an emotion which demonstrates your love and reverence and respect for your Creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in this life, when you truly fear God and respect the laws of God, what does the Holy Quran tell you? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "As for my servants, the true ones, لَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ." God has promised, if you live a life in which you fear God, you're God conscious, and respect the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you fulfill your obligations, then there is nothing to fear. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you safety. But you have to earn that safety, brothers and sisters. The safety in the grave, the safety on the day of judgment. This is something which we have to work for. This is why the commander of the faithful, Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam, even though he was the best creation after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he used to think about the safety and the fears of the day of judgment. When the Imam alayhi salam would go to Masjid al-Kufa in the midst of the night, after midnight, the Imam alayhi salam would speak to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ask yourself, do I truly love God? Don't I want to spend some private time with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The hadith al-Qudsi says, the one who claims to love me is a liar. If when the night sets in, they don't get up to spend some time with me. Doesn't everyone who's in love want to spend some private time with the one whom he loves? Absolutely. When you love someone, you want to spend private time with them. Have a conversation with them. Accept Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We forget about him. Every maybe once in a while, once a week, once a month, once a year, do we say something to Allah, shed a few tears. Brothers and sisters, these tears will give you safety on the day of judgment. The hadith says, in the middle of the night, when you shed a single tear, it extinguishes oceans of the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Especially the tear on Abi Abdullah al-Husayn. The hadith says, on the day of judgment, every human being, every eye shall be crying on the day of judgment, except the eye which cries on Abi Abdullah al-Husayn. But this is not enough. To cry is not enough. As we said in the first majlis, Al-Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam, he says, I love these gatherings, but you have to help me with your taqwa, with your actions. بِالْوَرَعِ وَالْإِجْتِهَادِ. The Imam says, you have to work hard, then you will achieve that safety on the day of judgment. Listen to the munajat of Ali ibn Abi Talib, the peak of God's creation during his time. He would go like a humble slave in the midst of the night in Masjid al-Kufa. And what did he say? إلهي وأسألك الأمان. Oh Allah, I ask you for safety. The Imam is asking for safety. Tonight, go home, brothers and sisters, and ask safety to be given to you by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When does the Imam ask safety for? يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. Oh Allah, I ask you for safety on that day in which nothing will help me, my wealth will not help me, my family cannot help me, except the one who comes with a pure heart. It is this pure heart that can save you on the day of judgment. إلهي وأسألك الأمان يوم يعض الظالم على يديه يقول يا ليتني اتخذت مع الرسول سبيلا. Oh Allah, I ask you for safety on the day on which the evil ones shall bite at their hands. They'll be regretful. Why did I do this? Why did I not follow the teachings of the Holy Prophet? وأسألك الأمان يوم يفر المرء من أخيه وأمه وأبيه وصاحبته وبنيه. Oh Allah, I ask you for safety on that day on which everyone will run from their brother, from their father, from their mother, from their spouses, from their wife, husband. Why? Because that day the test is so difficult and the tragedy is so big for those who have sinned. Oh Allah, give me safety on that day. مولاي يا مولاي أنت المولى وأنا العبد وهل يرحم العبد إلا المولى. Oh مولى, oh master, you are the master and I am the slave. And who other than the master can have mercy on the slave? مولاي يا مولاي أنت القوي وأنا الضعيف وهل يرحم الضعيف إلا القوي. Oh my master, you are the strong one and I am the weak one. Speak to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with these beautiful words of Amir al-Mu'mineen. And who other than the strong one can have mercy on the weak one? Brothers and sisters, if every night of your life you take 2, 3, 5 minutes speaking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, do you think you will fear the grave? Because you have a friend in the grave, and that's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We fear the grave because we will be there lonely, because we will not have any friend there. But if you befriend Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this life, there's nothing to fear. إِنَّ عِبَادِي لَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ. My true servants, they have nothing to worry about. They have nothing to be sorrowful for and nothing to be afraid of. When we examine fear, brothers and sisters, we see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests us with this emotion. And when you examine fear, you see how the family of Abi Abdullah al-Husayn was tested in Karbala. When you imagine those little children, after their father, Abi Abdullah al-Husayn, was massacred, those enemies attacked their tents. Doesn't the Holy Quran, وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ مِنَ الْخَوْفِ. We shall test you with some fear in this life. And no fear in history has existed like the day of Ashura. Little children running from one tent to another tent. Their clothes set to fire, their tents set to fire. When narrations tells us that there was a young boy by the name of Muhammad and his brother. They were the grandsons of Aqil from their father's side and the grandson of Imam Ali from their mother's side, because they were the sons of Khadija, the daughter of Imam Ali alayhi salam. You know, after the battle of Karbala, after the battle was over, they were looking for them. Where are these two boys? What happened to them? The narration tells us that they found them. There were some bushes. They found them behind the bushes. They were hugging each other and they had passed away. Because of the state of fear, because of how they were terrorized on the day of Ashura. Indeed, the family of the Imam alayhi salam had to experience this fear. But it is through this fear that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala elevated their status. When we examine on such a day what happened in Karbala, thousands and thousands of troops had gathered in the land of Karbala. Initially, Ibn Ziyad, along with Umar ibn Sa'ad, they had sent a warrior, a brave man in Kufa, by the name of Al-Hur ibn Yazid al-Riyahi. They sent 1,000 soldiers with him. Go and block Al-Husayn from reaching Kufa. Al-Hur with 1,000 soldiers, he goes in order to block the caravan of the Imam alayhi salam from reaching the city of Kufa. The Imam alayhi salam tells him, "Why are you blocking me?" He says, "This is the instruction of Ibn Ziyad, the governor." The Imam said, "But you are the ones who asked me to come here. The people of Kufa, they sent me letters." Al-Hur said, "Where? Which letters?" The Imam alayhi salam opened a camel load of letters and he gave it to him. He says, "Look at these letters. The people of Kufa sent it to me." Al-Hur says, "Well, I wasn't one of those who sent you the letter asking you to come, so I will block you from going to Kufa." The Imam alayhi salam was very disappointed. He says, "Okay, if you will not allow me to go towards Kufa, let me go back to where I came from. Let me go back to Medina." He says, "No, I will not let you." When the Imam alayhi salam realizes that, he says, "Thakalatka ummuk, may your mother weep over you. Why do you do this to me and my family? You're frightening my family." You know what Al-Hur says? He tells him, "Oh Hussein, had anyone other than you said this to me, I would have replied back and attacked their mother. But how can I attack you when your mother is Fatima? What can I say about your mother when she is the lady of the world?" He respected the Imam alayhi salam. He did not say anything. And some scholars say it is because this act of respect that maybe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided him to do tawbah. However, as Umar ibn Sa'ad arrives with 4,000 troops, now he had 5,000 troops in Karbala, Al-Hur realizes that Umar wants to kill the Imam. He tells him, "Oh Umar, this was not the plan. We simply were dispatched in order to stop him from going to Kufa. Do you really want to kill this man?" Umar bin Sa'ad said, "Yes, of course. The least of which that the heads will be severed and you will see that the limbs will fall. Absolutely, we will fight him." When Al-Hur realizes that these people want to kill Abi Abdullah al-Husayn, he had second thoughts. He was in a state of fear, trembling. And this is the lesson that we take. This is how you control your fears. He was in a state of fear. He was trembling. "I see myself between heaven and hell. And how can I choose anything over heaven, over paradise?" One of his companions sees him, "Oh, Hur, you seem frightened, you're shaking. If I were to be asked who is the most bravest person in Kufa, I would say you. What is this?" He tells him, "No, I know where I have to go now. I have to repent." Imagine this person, and brothers and sisters, we all have sins. We're full of sins. Is there room for Allah's mercy? Look at the story of Hadrat Hur. And see how he approached Al-Imam Abi Abdullah al-Husayn. He couldn't even raise his head. He lowered his head to the ground. And he slowly started to march towards Abi Abdullah al-Husayn. And he would say, "Allahumma ilayka tubtu wa unib. Oh Allah, to you I am returning. Oh Allah, to you I seek forgiveness. Oh Allah, forgive me. What have I done? فَقَدْ أَرَعَبْتُ قُلُوبَ أَوْلِيَائِكَ. Oh Allah, I put fear in the hearts of those little children of Abi Abdullah al-Husayn. Oh Allah, can you ever forgive me? Let me go to my Imam, see if he forgives me." He came down from his horse. He was lowering his head, going towards Abi Abdullah al-Husayn. Then he said his salam to Abi Abdullah al-Husayn. He says, "May God make me a sacrifice for you, O Husayn. I know what I have done to you. I know I frightened you. I stopped you from going to Kufa. But I swear to God, I did not know that they wanted to kill you. Now that I've realized they wanted to kill you, O Abu Abdullah, I want to be the first one to fall on the battlefield. I want to defend you. I want to die in your way. I want my blood to be spilled in your way, O Abi Abdullah." Is there room for my tawbah? The Imam alayhi salam says, yes, O Hur. If you truly repent, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will indeed forgive you. He seeks permission from the Imam alayhi salam. He goes out to the battlefield. He kills 40 of those enemies or so, so valiantly, so bravely. But then they surround him from every direction. They begin to strike him with their swords, with their arrows, with their spears, until he falls to the ground. As-salamu alayka ya Aba Abdullah. The companions of Imam al-Husayn, they go, they bring the body of al-Hur. The Imam alayhi salam sees his body. He's very pained to see him in that state. The Imam alayhi salam sits next to his body. Oh Hur, thank you for your sacrifice. Oh Hur, you are indeed a free man, just like the name that your mother gave you, al-Hur. Indeed, you are free in this life and free on the day of judgment. السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين. Raise your hand in dua, brothers and sisters, 5 times together, so Allah answers our hajat. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. أَمَّنْ يُجِيبُ الْمُضْطَرَّ إِذَا دَعَاهُ وَيَكْشِفُ السُّوءَ أَمَّنْ أَمَّنْ يُجِيبُ الْمُضْطَرَّ إِذَا دَعَاهُ وَيَكْشِفُ السُّوءَ يَا اللَّهُ يَا اللَّهُ يَا اللَّهُ يَا اللَّهُ يَا اللَّهُ يَا اللَّهُ. O Allah, hasten the reappearance of our master al-Imam al-Mahdi. O Allah, make us amongst his sincere companions and servants. O Allah, grant us the ziyarah of Abi Abi Abdullah al-Husayn. O Allah, grant us the shafa'ah of Abi Abdullah al-Husayn. O Allah, forgive us our sins. O Allah, guide us to the straight path. O Allah, all those who are in need, answer their needs. O Allah, all those who are ill, give them a speedy recovery. وإلى أرواح المؤمنين والمؤمنات نهدي ثواب سورة الفاتحة مسبوقة بالصلاة على محمد وآل محمد.